It's a clinical diagnosis and it's a syndrome, i.e. a collection of symptoms and signs. But the standard textbook definition is that it's a situation where the heart cannot meet the demands of the circulation. It's not the same as a heart attack. You can have a heart attack without having heart failure. It's not the same as a cardiac arrest, which is a rhythm disorder. But it's a specific condition which doctors recognize where congestion occurs in the lungs and in the tissues because the heart cannot pump properly. So the most common cause is where the heart muscle actually fails to contract properly. There are several clinical and medical reasons why that can happen. When the heart fails to contract, it's just pumping weakly. But nowadays, we see a different sort of heart failure where the heart can contract properly but doesn't actually relax. And this relaxation abnormality is often called diastolic heart failure, which is really only recently being increasingly recognized. Well, the symptoms of heart failure relate to the fact that, looking at it simplistically, there's back pressure because the pump isn't working. So if we take the lungs, which are normally like two dry sponges, if they become congested with fluid, they become like wet sponges, which are more difficult to move. So the first symptom is breathlessness. And this can be breathlessness initially on climbing stairs or walking up an incline. And as it gets worse, it can become breathlessness on walking on the flat, on doing things like bed making or housework or pushing a shopping trolley. And then when the lungs become really congested, the patient will notice as they lie flat in bed at night, their lungs fill up with fluid and they can't lie flat. They have to sleep sitting up. That's the left side of the heart. When the right side of the heart fails, it's the peripheral tissues that get congested. And the commonest thing that happens is the ankles swell, the abdomen may swell because the liver enlarges, there may be fluid at the base of the spine, and the patient may get very, very fatigued and lethargic. Well, any condition that damages the heart muscle can lead to heart failure. And this can be due to blocked arteries, the coronary arteries which supply the heart with blood. If the heart becomes short of blood and you have lots of heart attacks, the heart will stop beating. Then there are diseases of the valves that open and shut. And if they're left too long without treatment, that can put a strain on the heart that can damage it. And there are conditions that can primarily affect the heart muscle, which we call cardiomyopathies, which are specifically abnormalities of the heart muscle, for example, such as drinking too much alcohol, such as certain drugs, such as even viruses that can damage the heart muscle. There may well be underlying causes as well, such as anemia, where the heart is asked to do more work, or even a change in the heart rhythm. And there's a very common arrhythmia called atrial fibrillation, where the upper chambers of the heart go out of rhythm, and a patient may have no symptoms until they develop this arrhythmia, and then the heart can fail. Now, there are other less common causes, such as some infiltrative diseases, which can particularly affect the relaxation. And one of the most common of those is long-standing untreated high blood pressure, which can commonly cause heart failure if it's not treated properly. So obviously prevention is better than cure, but if someone has heart failure, then there are several treatments available. First of all, let's correct the underlying cause. So treat the anemia, treat the rhythm disorder, reduce salt intake, treat the high blood pressure. But then there are drugs known as diuretics, which are commonly known as water tablets, which can be given by mouth or intravenously, which make the kidneys get rid of the excess fluid and clear the congestion. There are other drugs we use to take the strain off the heart, several groups of drugs, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers and nitrates, all of which have beneficial effects and ease the load on the strained heart. Apart from drugs, there are some devices that we can use to improve the function of the heart. For example, there are special sorts of pacemaker called resynchronization pacemakers, which force the chambers of the heart to beat more synchronously and improve function and can actually improve life expectancy. And they can often be combined with a device called a defibrillator, which will administer a life-saving electric shock if a patient with heart failure goes into an unstable, life-threatening rhythm. In certain circumstances, surgery can be indicated to correct an abnormal valve or to bypass the coronary arteries.